Here. Good evening.
Good evening.
So, roll call, Chair Freeman.
Here.
Secretary Spaulding is here. Commissioner Dickey.
Here.
Commissioner Vella. Maybe not yet. Commissioner Pulvarenti.
Here.
Commissioner Rouse.
Here.
Commissioner Dombach.
Here.
Commissioner Ituri, I believe, is excused tonight. Commissioner Kokkonen. Commissioner Kokkonen. Commissioner Hermosillo is excused tonight. Commissioner Chrysler.
Here.
Commissioner Truesdell.
Here. I may need permission to leave early. I had surgery today, so I'm going to hang in as long as I can.
Thank you for that.
I hope you feel better.
Yes. Take care. Commissioner Brown.
Here.
All right. Commissioner Felder.
Here.
Commissioner Lowe.
Here.
Commissioner Bramfitt.
Here.
Commissioner Cornwall has recused herself. And our county ex officio alternate, Greg Carr, is excused tonight. Have I missed anybody?
I do not believe so.
Thank you.
You did get Commissioner Kokkonen, right? Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, now let's, if we may have the flag, and we'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance, please. And repeating after me, I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of
America and to the
Republic
for which it stands,
for one nation,
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you for that. I would like to announce that chat and Q&A have been turned off for the meeting. This is to prevent any potential violations of the Brown Act and public comment outside of the time when public comment is open. Our first item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes of the meeting of September 28th. And I would ask if anybody had any revisions based on their review of those minutes, or whether I was to receive a motion to...
I move to approve.
Do I have a second?
A second.
Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Or raise your hands. All those not in favor, say nay or thumbs down. The resolution is passed and we have approved the minutes of September 28th. At this point, we move to item number 3 on our agenda, which is public comment. I want to remind everybody that it's limited to items not appearing on the agenda. We will give you 2 minutes to speak. Please, I'm asking the public to use their raise hand function if they wish to speak. Call-in users are to press *9 to raise their hand and *6 when they hear the prompt to unmute.
I'm not seeing any raised hands, Chair Freeman.
Okay. Counting backwards. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Bingo. Public comment is now closed for today's meeting, and we will proceed to item number 4 on our agenda, which is the Sonoma Developmental Center SDC specific plan and final EIR. We are looking for a resolution from the commissioner.
Chairman, you are
cutting in and out.
Can't hear you very well.
We can't hear you.
Okay, well, I've unlocked.
Thank you, Matt.
So, repeating once again, item number 4, Sonoma Developmental Center, which is the SDC specific plan and final EIR. We are looking for a resolution on this from the commissioners. The presentation will be by Permit Sonoma staff. The site address is 15000 Arnold Drive in Eldridge. The project description is as follows. The project is a specific plan that would cover all state-owned Sonoma Developmental Center property, encompassing approximately 945 acres or about 1.5 square miles, which includes a developed core campus covering approximately 180 acres, the surrounding approximately 755 acres of contiguous open space, and the 11-acre non-contiguous Camp Villa grounds within Jack London State Historic Park. The plan proposes to reduce the existing developed core campus for redevelopment of up to 1,000 units of various housing types and 410,000 square feet of non-residential use, 170,000 square feet of new non-residential use, and 240 square feet of adaptive reuse of existing buildings to accommodate 940 jobs. The plan proposes design guidelines and development standards, as well as updated zoning designations to implement the plan. Adoption of the plan requires certification of the final EIR, a general plan amendment, and zone change amendment by the Sonoma County Board of Supervisors. And the final specific plan has been released along with the final EIR. And at this point, I would turn it over to our presenter from the county, and that is Mr. Brian O.
Thank you, Chair, and good evening to the commission. Can everyone hear me okay?
All right. Mr. O, can I just say one thing real quickly?
Please.
Thank you. I just wanted to remind people of, we will first have the presentation by you. We will then have questions by the commissioners. Then we will have questions and comments from the public. We will then have a response by the applicant if required based on those questions and comments from the public. And then we will turn to commissioners for comments and then the resolution after that. I just want to be clear about the steps here so everybody's clear. Thank you very much.
All right. So thank you so much for the time and opportunity. I was just looking at the notes and it looks like this is my third consecutive time coming here. And so, and also nice to see and meet many of you in person for the first time during the site tour. And so my name is Brian O. I'm the Comprehensive Planning Manager for Permit Sonoma. We are the local planning agency for unincorporated Sonoma, which the state Sonoma Developmental Center property is within. And so I'm here to talk to you today. We have, we are kicking off a series. So this is actually the kickoff to a series of public hearings for the specific plan for Sonoma Developmental Center. And so I just have a short slide deck here just to get this shared if I can. Screen one. Okay. So the purpose of the meeting today is for the CAC to receive a staff presentation on the specific plan and the final EIR. And ultimately there's a resolution to potentially consider a recommendation to the Planning Commission. And so tomorrow afternoon, I will be in front of the Planning Commission on three action items. And so this is exactly just copy and paste from the staff report for tomorrow. And so item number one is to conduct a public hearing. And that will be, we'll start tomorrow afternoon. This will cover both the specific plan and then the final environmental impact report. And then there's two additional actions that the Planning Commission will consider. And it's two and three here. And so the first would be to approve a resolution recommending that the board certify the final EIR, which has been public, now, as well as adopt a statement of overriding considerations and findings of fact related to the certification of the final EIR. And the third action would be for the Planning Commission to consider a recommendation to adopt general plan amendments to our current general plan maps and policies focused in the land use element, which will enable the specific plan and ensure vertical consistency between specific plan and our overarching county general plan. And so with that, it would be the adoption of the specific plan, as well as approving the staff recommended zoning code changes, as well as changes to related maps. And just a short refresh on where we've started this process. And so we are culminating a 3+ year process. And so this specific process kicked off at the end of 2019. And with the project goals stated clearly in the state legislation, maximize protection of open space, priority for housing, specifically for housing, affordable housing, as well as housing for individuals with developmental disabilities. And the legislation was clear that the local county, Sonoma County, would be the lead agency in developing a specific plan. It also highlights the need and recognition for economic feasibility. So putting out a plan that is both feasible, but also representative of that last point there, the community vision and guiding principles. And so this was the vision and guiding principles that were developed through input from the community. With input from the planning advisory team, and then ultimately through a workshop with the Board of Supervisors January of this year. And so there's two documents in the specific plan. So it's the specific plan, and that's the 20-year land use plan. It identifies goals and policies. Many of you in looking through the plan, we'll recognize a number of those policies that were developed through different workshops, focus groups, different planning exercises over the past 3+ years. And then there's a final chapter for implementation and financing. And so it walks through, a handful of different options on how there could be a financing mechanism to realize this 20-year land use plan. The other document is the final environmental impact report. And so this builds off of the draft. And so I was here in August during the public comment period, just to bring awareness to the period. We received a number of comments, 1,200 individual comments, comments from public agencies such as the City of Sonoma and the Sonoma Valley Fire District. And so we've spent the better part of closing out the public comment period through this month to be responsive and provide responses to each and every one of those comments and letters. And so it concludes and reaffirms what the draft EIR had analyzed and disclosed regarding project impacts in the environment. We looked at wildfire impacts, transportation, historic resources, biotic resources, cultural. It's a quite extensive, I believe it's 62 different environmental impacts. And then we looked at alternatives. And so this was we got some direction from the Board of Supervisors in the January workshop to really look at, different levels of density. And so anything from 450 from the low development alternative upwards to the 750 units as the lower density alternative presented in the EIR. So we all know the project context, but just to orient ourselves, we are the red parcel. So it's five parcels that make up the Sonoma Developmental Center and under the ownership of the State Department of General Services. And so this is just south of Glen Ellen, as well as it's bisected with Arnold Drive, both sides of Arnold Drive, and north of both the Springs and the city of Sonoma. And a high-level summary of the specific plan, you know, it reiterates the state legislation. So what the county of Sonoma and the state had put together and come up with that three-year planning process, and it hits those two points directly. So expansion of existing open space preservation to ensure that the open space that we all enjoy now will continue in perpetuity for as a public resource. It also looks at a housing and job balance and a diverse set of housing types and diverse set of jobs as well under the 410,000 square foot proposal for non-residential. And it also prioritizes affordable housing, housing for individuals with developmental disabilities. And, you know, it is a return as the Sonoma Developmental Center as a key job center within Sonoma Valley. And then additionally, you know, this is not a greenfield. It's there are a number of buildings with historic significance. And so one of the key themes that does come out through the plan is this commitment to preserve the historic character of the Sonoma State Home Historic District. And so this is the site in its entirety. It's the Camp Villa. So we're looking northward here, Arnold Drive. The green is the proposed preserved open space, which is inclusive of Camp Villa, as well as additional site considerations, you know, acknowledging that this is a key habitat connectivity corridor, acknowledging that it is a critical wildlife corridor. You know, we have reduced the footprint of the existing developed campus to really ensure that you know, we're maximizing the space, but we're also recognizing that there is a need to have some level of buffer between the open space and the developed campus. And so in the dark green, you see managed landscape, a dual purpose to act as a fire buffer, as well as the expanded wildlife. This is commonly known as the pinch point here. And so there's been a lot of discussion around protection and expansion of this critical wildlife habitat just north of campus and south of Sutton Field Lake. And so another one of the key tenets is mobility. And so what you see here, quarter mile radius, everything within walking distance for many from the central green. And so, you know, one of the principles here was to develop a walkable core, connectivity, both with regional transit systems, a well-connected walking and biking network throughout the campus to provide good and safe alternatives for people to not use their automobiles. And then part of the this discussion has predated this planning process, but a lot of discussion around, you know, how are we creating an additional connection for a west, an east to west connection between Arnold Drive and Highway 12. And so part of the proposed project would has been evaluated to have some connection. And so the specific plan is not going to be that specific in identifying a location, but we have evaluated the impacts of this piece of the project. And then I mentioned a variety of land uses. And so 410,000 square feet of non-residential to complement the 1,000 housing units. And just a point of clarification, the number of units that was evaluated is inclusive of any additional existing density bonuses that a project proponent may be able to get. And so, you know, we wanted to make sure that part of the assessment includes, you know, how, what additional bonuses one may be able to get, and sort of all of that under the commitment and the policy that of those 1,000 housing units, 283 of those units would be deed restricted for low income families and individuals. So this map is slightly revised from what was released in the draft. And so hopefully a little bit more clarity. You know, I got a lot of feedback just on readability. And so, you know, we made a slight change here just to make the distinction between what is recommended to be preserved versus recommended suggested for removal. And so the purple recommended to preserve, the orange is the remove if necessary. And then the gray are the non-contributing buildings that are on campus. So most of those are east of Arnold Drive, built in post-World War II in the 50s and do not contribute to the historic significance of the historic district. So here's a few examples locally, you know, as close just north of this Hotel Chauvet in the downtown Glen Allen area, adaptively reusing a historic building for residential, and then also looking at some of the small lot housing types that we see both in Petaluma and in Healdsburg. Healdsburg down here. And also, you know, on the next slide, there is a, you know, based on a lot of the feedback that we received on the draft specific plan, you know, we took a lot of the comments and wanted to provide some more strength and some more teeth behind the policies. And so now with the revised policies, there's further prioritization of affordable housing and housing for individuals with developmental disabilities. And so you'll see some changes within the policies that we're recommending to Planning Commission. We've also revised permitted uses. So this was a hot topic at the conclusion of the tour. And so there is a revised set of permitted uses with a clear focus and intention in key areas such as the preserved open space. And so removing a number of the proposed permitted uses there, as well as within the core campus. We're also expanding protection of the wildlife corridor in addition to the initial proposal. And so ensuring that, you know, as we are shrinking the footprint of the existing developed campus, so I'm thinking the northeast corner, ensuring that a future developer will be compelled to demolish those existing buildings to open up the pinch point within the wildlife corridor prior to getting too far down the road in terms of development of new housing. And then some more clarification on the environmental permitting actions for a future project applicant. And so the County of Sonoma is not a developer. And, you know, there's been discussion just around the sequencing between what the state is doing with the disposition of the property. And so we wanted to clarify, you know, some of those actions that a future project applicant will have to do. And so this is a specific plan. It's a program level EIR. And so there's more clarity on the expectations of what will happen at the conclusion of the specific planning process. And so for the environmental impact report, the top environmental concerns identified through our engagement process, you know, top of mind water, you know, during this period of time. And so is there an adequate water supply for the proposed project? What about evacuation? It's a region, you know, traumatized, has the real lived experience of evacuating out of their homes in a wildfire and a emergency. And so that was something that we looked at closely and evaluated to really understand the impacts. You know, what becomes of the proposed connection to Highway 12, and what are the consequences and impacts that it may have? And so that was another one we looked at. Biological habitat, again, key critical wildlife corridor, habitat, connectivity corridor within Sonoma Valley. And it's, again, another top concern that we evaluated, as well as the historic resources on campus and the transportation impacts. And so how many miles will each person that will eventually or potentially live here, how many miles will they generate every day? And that's a clear impact that we need to understand. And so just a summary, because I've seen a couple questions related to this. The final environmental impact report is not a separate document, right? So it is the draft environmental impact report plus the responses to comment. And so the bulk of what was released 9 days ago were the county responses to all the public comment. And then in chapter 3 are the changes to the draft EIR. And so between those three components, that is what is considered the final environmental impact report. And so again, evaluated 62 environmental impacts across 16 different topics. The staff conclusion is of those 62, there are two significant and unavoidable impacts. One is related to vehicle miles traveled, the other related to historic resources. And reaffirming the question around self, what is a self-mitigating document? And so we are continuing. So part of the final EIR addresses this question on a self-mitigating environmental impact report. And so many of those policies that make the specific plan strong are the ways, is the strongest way to ensure environmental sustainability. Project alternatives is still the same. So proposed plan, 1,000 housing units, up to 940 jobs, which is inclusive of the new connection between Arnold Drive and Highway 12. We looked at no project alternatives. So should the board decide that there is not a preferred plan, we hypothesize, you know, based on everything that we know of this project and the project goals, two different alternatives. And then we also looked at the two reduced development alternatives, which has the 750 units as well as the 450, which is also, we identify as the environmentally superior alternative. And so I have one more slide, and I just wanted to leave this in here. So this is a rendering of, we're looking at the top half of your screen is a rendering of, with the design standards, with the vision and the guiding principles and all the policies that make up the specific plan, what this place could look like. And so it has a nice mix of small lot housing development with the connection to the historic agricultural use. And then the bottom half of your screen, we're looking in the background at the main building. And so reimagining that central square as a community place for not just the Sonoma Developmental Center, but also for the greater Sonoma Valley region. And so that concludes my presentation. I did leave a slide in here and just to offer up to Chair Freeman, if there is some sort of order or format that you'd like to go through, I may suggest, utilizing the specific plan chapters and the big themes as a way to potentially walk through this discussion. And with that, I will turn it back over to Chair Freeman.
Thank you, Mr. O. That's actually a helpful slide, I think, and kind of puts it in a framework, I think, for a lot of us. At this point, just wondering how you might. Friend, would you mind putting and I ask, well, I don't know how to do this. If I ask people to follow
that. Can't hear you.
You can't hear you.
Thank you for telling me. I appreciate it. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So I don't think going by that slide is going to really work, Brian. I think it's helpful to kind of lay it out for people and show them the lines with which they can ask, but I think what we'll do is just go to my fellow commissioners and ask them what questions they have. And I apologize in advance that it will probably be all over the place. But just so you know, everybody will have a chance to ask their questions. So any of you who want to ask questions, please raise your hand and we'll call on you in the order of hands raised. Thank you.
I would just say I can hear you, but all I can see is your forehead.
It's much better than the rest of me.
Yes,
so
it is.
Good. So
can we define the density
probably my
bonus?
Best quality, just to be clear. But that's okay. So there we go. So I guess I do see Commissioner Truesdale has her hand up. If you want to go ahead and ask your questions, I'd appreciate it.
Okay, I have several questions, but my first one, I have a copy of the report here. It's 2,500 pages, and my apologies, I haven't been able to even make a dent in it. I got it on Monday, and it's a lot. So, but my question about the employer of the 900 jobs. Do we have any sense of who that's going to be? And I guess my concern is, where are these people going to live? Because there are 900 jobs and 1,000 units. And if they don't live on site, are they supposed to take public transportation? Or are they supposed to park in a location? And has a facility been planned for parking 900 cars? I guess that's my question. The site seems to be pretty specific to the housing units, but what about the employment piece?
So So, Chair, should I just go one at a time?
I'm thinking that's going to be the best method for us to follow.
Excellent. And Gwen, I apologize if I don't get to respond to every piece. There's a little bit of choppiness at the end. So just let me know if I didn't cover something. And so just a point of clarification, the specific plan essentially creates the footprint. And so there's different types of land uses that we are proposing. So everything from institutional to commercial, local, retail, as well as public facilities. And so that's all we're identifying through the specific plan. And then ultimately, whoever purchases the property, right, will have to go through a process with the county based on that footprint and come up with the project proposal. And so, there's no specific, type in mind or a specific company in mind. All we can do at this point with the specific plan is to lay the foundation, establish that footprint of what can go there. So institutional use, public facility use, office space, the proposed zoning for a hotel. And then ultimately it's up to the private side to come up with the end user. And so we're just creating that footprint. We're allowing for a diverse mix of types of jobs. And I think the last piece that you asked about where people are going to live, part of this is there's this recognition that there is a need for housing, a need for jobs, and a need to try and balance that locally. And so, there's nothing holding someone to live there. Each of those future uses will have some level of parking standards. So those are all the design standards that are identified in the specific plan. And so any project that comes in, whether it's a coffee shop, office space, research and development, they'll all have to incorporate a parking requirement as part of their project.
Vicki, I see your hand is up. And Commissioner Smalding will come to you just after Mr. Dickey.
A question occurs to me. In the unlikely event that the job projections are in or above the 900 plus that you're assuming, what kind of projections are you making for the impacts based on that? I mean, what happens if all of a sudden these businesses that you are suggesting now need 1,200 people to run their companies, run their jobs, have to be on site to maintain the hotel and all the rest? Are there projections for the impacts based on traffic, water use, all of the other ancillary considerations?
Thank you, Vice Chair Dickey. So part of the exercise that went into the environmental impact report is inclusive of all, it's formulaic. So X number of square feet for institutional use, there's a water usage. And so that was done, completed. For example, you'll see those numbers in the water supply assessment. And so that is applied to both the vehicle miles traveled, as well as other impacts that are identified in the EIR.
JP, do you have additional questions or?
No, sorry. I'll take my hand down. Thank you.
That's all right. Commissioner Rouse, I'm going to go to Commissioner Spaulding first, and then I'll come to you. Commissioner Spaulding, if you'd take yourself off mute.
Thank you. I know you've covered this topic with us before, but could you go over again the notion of how the definition of financial feasibility? So much is hanging on that, and I confess I'm still a little unclear how you came up with whatever will be or not be financially feasible.
Certainly. Thank you, Commissioner Spaulding. And so financial feasibility for us, part of the background documents, part of our consulting team included Kaiser Marston and Associates. And so their local economic consulting firm. And so they provided a feasibility analysis. And so it outlined the likelihood or the demand, projected demand for certain types of housing, certain types of non-residential. And then on top, so we have, you know, that was the report that went into consideration. And then we also have the, a lot of the work that the state had done prior to us being involved at this level and scale was evaluating the existing buildings, the cost that it would take to adaptively reuse those buildings. And then something to keep in mind, I mean, those buildings were for a very specific purpose. And so the way that they're designed had a singular purpose of housing people, most of them, as well as hospital use. And so then it's a balance that we have to weigh. We want to try to preserve the history of the site and the buildings and the architectural quality. There's a cost that is associated with that. There's a cost that's associated with new construction, right? And so we took projections from what the state provided us. We took a look at that. We looked at the feasibility analysis, and those are the numbers that are presented. One of the considerations that went into the project proposal.
So, thank you. Did I miss that information about the actual numbers? Is that somewhere in the EIR? In other words, I still don't know what the Kaiser
Marston. Yeah, so I am happy to, I can follow up. It's not in the, I think we touch on it in the EIR, but the report itself is one of our background documents on the specific plan website. And so I'm gonna take a list here of the questions, and if there's anything to follow up, I'll happily forward that to Ariel.
Thank you.
Commissioner Spaulding, Commissioner Rouse, I believe you had some questions.
Yes, new to the commission, but obviously overwhelmed by the 2,500 pages of the EIR that I've tried to go through, but not completely. Can somebody define to me, because I don't understand, the density bonus? What does that mean? How does that impact what we're looking at here tonight?
Thank you, Commissioner. Density bonus references essentially it's an incentive if you are building affordable housing, you are allowed through either the state or the county to build additional units on top of whatever is allowed with the zoning. And so when we took a look at them, sorry, were you going to say something?
No, go ahead. Sorry. Oh.
And so what we looked at was, what the limit, the 1,000 housing units is inclusive of any existing density bonuses that a developer.
So that includes all the density bonuses that, so the maximum could be with the density bonuses, 1,000 units with that in consideration.
Yeah, so there's a few layers. So if you look, so in the specific plan, I think it's chapter four, it identifies a not to exceed base number.
Okay.
And so it's 733.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is inclusive of the 550 market rate units. Plus, we have a requirement here that goes above and beyond the 15 or 20% that many jurisdictions do, a 20% inclusionary. So the developer is going to have to build 25% of their total housing, and this will likely be done in pieces. 25% of those units will have to be deed restricted affordable.
Is that off the 733 or is that?
So it's the 550 market rate units,
okay,
plus the 183, which gets you the
733.
Correct. And then on top of that, if you're hitting the 25% inclusionary, there's a whole chart and there's way too many permutations. It depends on how many units a developer wants to build for very low or extremely low or moderate income. And so,
but the 530 market rate units are not part of that calculation. Is that correct?
It is part
of the calculation. Because, I mean, if you're into the 530 market rates, it's the 173 that have that wiggle room, if you will.
Yes, but so the way that the state density bonuses work, it is important for us to establish that ceiling, and that's why there's nowhere in this document, it says it will equal 1,000 units, but if right. we were to do that, then it would potentially go above and beyond that. And so
that's what I think is important. Is the 1,000 real, or right. if we take the 173 plus the 25, percent,
yes.
Does that become the real number?
Correct. So
I think that's important, right? I mean, I think that's people need to understand what that real final number becomes. We talk about 1,000, but it's not really 1,000. It's more than 1,000.
No. It is 1,000. So that's why in there it says the limit for the base number of housing units is 733. And so that's inclusive of the 550 units of market rate housing plus 183.
Okay, yeah.
And so by providing a 25% inclusionary housing requirement, a developer will able to achieve a density bonus, and they'll get an additional 190 market rate units.
Right.
And then on top of that, there's a policy in there, right? So this whole, the whole mission here, or one of the top priorities, is to maximize and prioritize housing that's deed restricted affordable. And mm-hmm. so on top of that is we have evaluated with that within the 1,000 units, a 100% 100 unit, fully 100% fully affordable, fully deed restricted housing development to be built on site. And so with all of that, that equals the 1,000.
1,000. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for that line of discussion, Commissioner Rouse. Do we have other questions? Oh, Commissioner Lowe.
Thank you. The inclusion of the hotel, which has been, I think, the source of a lot of the questions regarding people going in and out and where they're going to live and so forth. Is the hotel... if this thing passes in its current format, there's nothing else that could take its place. It has to be a hotel, or can the economic portion of this plan be altered to put another business of some sort or nonprofit or educational institution in its place.
Correct. Yes.
Yes, all of that is correct. So we're not approving a hotel. We're approving in concept a something that will generate employment and approximate employment, et cetera. Is that correct?
Just to clarify, the proposed zoning, so if you look at the permitted use table, and this goes back to this question about economic feasibility, we are essentially tying the biggest ticket item in cost, right? I think it was stop number three that we had mm-hmm. on the site tour, which is the main building. And so understanding that there's a severe amount of work that will be needed, one option, so it will be zoned to allow for a hotel. That's not to say a hotel has to go there. And there are a lot of other equivalent uses. If we look at from an economic perspective, there aren't many economically equivalent uses, but to your point, Commissioner, if there is something that is identified that is financially feasible, there's nothing that says you have to put a hotel in there. And that's this whole concept of the flex space, which would allow other uses to potentially fit in the footprint.
So a climate center or educational institution, all of those would not need different zoning than is currently there. Based Correct. On, okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Commissioner Brown.
Thank you. I had a couple of specific questions and I want to make sure I read draft on the final EIR correctly. Brian, I think you said in your presentation to us that there were 283 deed restricted units for low-income families, if you will, low-income families. I read that deed restriction applying only to the persons with developmental disabilities. That's the way I read it.
So I will look at that policy through that lens. There's nothing to say that the deed restricted housing couldn't be eligible for an individual with developmental disabilities, but.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the deed restriction, as I read your document, applies only to those units occupied by or purchased by persons with developmental disabilities. It wasn't intended to limit the low cost or low income properties, if you will, homes. Is that correct?
It's incorrect. So it's deed restricted based on income. And then there's an additional policy that identifies through working with the Parent Hospital Association, which is a legacy of the Sonoma Developmental Center, families and clients that that live there and were cared for. There's an additional policy that there will be at least five deed restricted homes.
So the total number of homes that will be deed restricted based on income is 283. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay. My second question is regarding the travel times from evacuation areas. Right? Do I understand that the time to evacuate was calculated only to the perimeter of an evacuation area, not to a place of safety?
To a perimeter of an evacuation area. So
it said it may be additional time required to reach the ultimate evacuation destination, but it looks like it's from one TAZ to another TAZ.
Correct. Well, so that's how that is how the Sonoma County Transportation Authority's travel model is built, is going from one TAZ to another.
So it could be to the beginning of a TAZ. It goes back to the question about are these evacuation times realistic? And if it is defined as from one area to the beginning, the periphery, perimeter of another area, then it makes a little more sense. I'm not saying I'm in agreement with them, as opposed to what I think, certainly I was, and many of us were thinking, is this really, does this really deal with the question of getting out of the SDC area and getting down to perhaps somewhere Verano, say, for example, in Sonoma? But you're only talking to the next boundary. That's where the model calculates, right?
It calculates evacuation from the campus to a place of safety, yes.
Which could be, you know, a couple of miles down on Arnold Road, because that's the beginning of the next transportation analysis zone, right?
So yeah, there's contiguous TAZs throughout the county.
I guess my other question had to do with the water system. And as I understand it, the current treatment plant was shut down about 2.5 years ago, and the distribution system is beyond useful life and obsolete. Is that correct?
Correct. I mean, so a lot of, yes, it is correct.
So then the issue comes back to where does the water come from if it doesn't come from the Valley of the Moon system, which supports the rest of Sonoma Valley.
So the water is generated on site, and so part of the water supply assessment that was completed by Valley of the Moon Water District, and so that assessment was done in partnership with the county, with Sonoma Water, as well as the local retailer. It is their assessment that there is adequate water supply. In fact, more than adequate water supply for the proposed project.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown. Commissioner Kokanen, please.
Thank you for the presentation. I actually had a follow-up question to Commissioner Lowe's regarding space that was designated as potential for hotel. Obviously, there doesn't need to be one. But you mentioned the sort of the flexibility factor when it comes to that particular location. And I was just curious, when you say flexibility, and I apologize if it's covered in more detail in the plan, I might have missed it, but if it is flexible and conceivably a mixed use urban setting, is it equally possible that it might not be a hotel, but once sold to a development rights are sold, it could be mixed use retail, it could end up being other applications which aren't necessarily focused on hotel use or something else that's lower impact, and it could actually involve retail, that sort of stuff. Just wanted to make sure that was clarified. Thanks.
Yes, just to confirm and reaffirm, again, this, we've evaluated sort of a mix ultimately, and this is, that was grounded in the discussions that we had with the public, what's been identified through the community vision and guiding principles, what's identified in the state legislation. But ultimately, we have no control over what the end user may be. One thing that the specific plan will control is we've identified that footprint. And so part of what we what we'll have to do, right? So we adopt the plan, and then there's going to be an implementation phase that will likely take 20 years. As this place redevelops, like it likely will not redevelop as one entity. It likely will take multiple developers, you know, to approach different land uses. At the end of the day, whatever project comes in the door here at Permit Sonoma will need to go through that implementation checklist. And so does it meet, let's say we're halfway in 10 years down the road and you know, all of the 410,000 square feet of non-residential is built. There's going to be a whole other, that's where, I mean, the ceiling has been reached. Depending on what that project looks like, there may be additional analysis that may be required, additional entitlements, but it's not an open door to, you know, add things in. And so I talked a little bit about the equivalent. And so let's just use the hotel as an example. Let's say that it generates, you know, X number of vehicle miles traveled. It generates water usage per acre. Let's say something comes in, right? It's the climate focused center. It will come in with a likely lower footprint and lower impact. And so long as it is a permitted use based on the zoning. And so there's a very, I think it's a 3-page permitted use table. So long as it is a permitted use, then that's something that we could potentially see here. That's not a hotel.
Can I follow a question? That's okay, Chair Freeman. So Mr. One other question. You had the keyword in there, which was helpful. So you mentioned the footprint a couple of times. So, you know, use an extreme example just to, you know, kind of play out the scenario. It's unlikely that given that footprint, say a mall could go in. I know it's an extreme example, but just want to kind of draw it out so that it's totally clear that the footprint is the restriction on, among maybe a few other things later, but how much that particular portion of the real estate could be developed. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay, thanks.
Commissioner Kokanen, do I have any other hands that would like to go up from other commissioners at this point? Commissioner Domba.
Yes, Brian, I recall that it's outlined that for the residential building, that the affordable houses and dwellings need to be built kind of at the same pace as the market value. Can you remind me with regard to the commercial space, can that be built out before residential space, or is there a provision that has kind of equity around the build out of both residential and commercial?
Great question. Thank you, Commissioner. So there is a clear, so the vision is we start building from the central core. And so much of the commercial, the mixed use is focused on the west side of campus. And so there is a clear policy in there. I don't have it in front of me, but essentially there's a ceiling. You must build X thousand, I think it's in the tens, square feet of non-residential prior to any of the housing that gets developed on the east side of campus, so east of Arnold Drive.
And the idea there is related to the long-term funding proposal. Is that correct?
Yes, but also, I mean, I think part of it is attributed to this vision, right? We have this vision for a walkable, walkable place, amenities that are, you know, within access distance. And so you can't have just housing in this location and not, to me, like it just doesn't line up with what the vision the community had identified through the vision and the guiding principles.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get a sense of the urgency of building the housing as well. Like if it's 20 years, I'm trying to get a sense of that. Maybe you can help me to make sure that there is some as developers are chosen, there's some urgency around that, the housing development as well.
Yeah, so in chapter seven, there's a sort of hypothetical based on, you know, best practices, but, you know, based on, you know, how a development of this size may be developed over 20 years. And so there's a phasing that we're sort of assuming. It's not a, you know, policy-based phasing. But we do think just based on where I think with the policies that we're proposing, we feel that there will be sort of a incremental growth that happens starting with the central green space. There currently is not, I mean, we have policies related to, you know, building the affordable housing along with the market rate. And part of that, what we're hearing is that's just for something to be financially feasible, it needs to come together in some way, right? We need to build some cash flow with the market rate in order to build the inclusionary and the subsidized housing. And so that's the extent of what we've, you know, we don't want the market rate to happen and then the inclusionary to not happen at the end. And we identify that that's a top priority. And so that went into the proposal to ensure that they go hand in hand.
So with X comes Y is what you're saying, basically. I mean,
with market rate housing comes deed restricted, correct? I mean, so on the surface, right, there's specific policies in there. You shouldn't be able to tell the difference, right? We're using the same quality. So this is a county code. Inclusionary units shall be built with the same quality of materials. On the outside, you should not be able to tell the difference. And so that's something, again, we wanted to prioritize in this plan.
Are you finished with your line of questioning?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
Commissioner Felder?
Yes. You have in the current proposal for the primary plan, 1,000 units of housing, of which 500 and some are market rate. Is there any restriction on the type of market rate housing in terms of its size and therefore its affordability to limit it to provide smaller houses that are more affordable even in the market rate? Or is it just wide open so you can build mega mansions and make more profit for a developer?
Thank you for the question, Commissioner Felder. So SDC will have zero mega or even mansions. Part of the design standards for each of the lots. So again, a wide range. We have multifamily housing types. We have detached as well as attached single family. No lot will be larger than 5,000 square feet. Additionally, there are setbacks and floor to area ratios to ensure that these are built small and to your point, they're more attractive and market ready for what we're calling the missing middle income, right? So families, couples, people that make slightly or just enough that are priced out of sort of market rate, what we typically see with single family homes and the housing prices in Sonoma Valley, but they make too much, so they aren't eligible for the deed restricted affordable housing. And so I like to say all housing here will be affordable. There will be deed restricted, but there will also be some of the rest will be the sort of smaller, more compact sub, and we're talking the the lot size. So 5,000 square foot, 4,000 square foot lots for a much smaller housing product that you don't see much of in not just in Sonoma Valley, but throughout the county.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Felder. And Brian, just Mr. Oak, to, there is a cap on the height. There's a height limitation as well, right?
Exactly. So right. Between right. The building height, between the
FAR,
the massing, the FAR,
yep.
With the lot sizes, there's not a whole lot.
Right. Yeah, no, I just wanted to make sure there was a top. Yes. You didn't talk about the top, and I wanted to make sure
that. Yes, thank you. Thank you for that.
So, Commissioner Chrysler, you had a question. Are you still in a position to ask that?
My question just got answered. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you. Commissioner Ruth, you had your hand up. Rouse, excuse me. Well, now you're on mute.
It's happened since kindergarten, so Roos or Rouse doesn't matter much to me. 5,500 square foot, no mega mansions, height limitations. Can we assume that we're talking about an under 2,000 square foot house? Is that what we're, I mean, is that being laid out or is that something that we're assuming, I guess?
It's not so specific to say, you know, what the average ends up being, and it's, and partly by design. And so part of what the revised policies includes is on top of the site specific FAR, there is a district specific FAR. And so that's to make sure that there's some uniformity throughout the campus. And so there won't be, you know, this sort of concentration of homes, this concentration of sort of some of the bigger square foot homes. That's something we could look at. You know, it's something that we've thought about. I think ultimately, if you look at specific plans, it doesn't get to that level of specificity. Feels yeah. like it may be limiting. But we feel confident with what we've proposed and all the different limitations that.
But is there a percentage of if you're saying that 5,500 square feet is the maximum size for the sake of conversation, I mean, are we assuming that two-story home with 2,000 square feet is going to take up 25% of that lot or whatever the number is? I don't have a calculator, but is that kind of how we're looking at this thing? I mean, we're not going to have 6,000 square foot houses mixed with 2,000 square foot houses. It's not going to be the mega mansions or whatever you want to call it mixed with a more conservative 2,000 square foot house. That probably at the top of it is what it feels like.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you. Commissioner Pulverinti, you had your hand up.
If I'm correct, this proposed development is nothing like we've ever done before in the Valley. Is that correct, Brian?
Well, I think the Valley offers housing opportunities at this scale for one specific project. This is quite unique throughout the region.
And the mixed use. We may have developments, housing developments within Sonoma and Sonoma Valley, but not a mixed use like this, where you would have commercial housing, possibly a hotel. So you've conducted several meetings with the community. And I was wondering if you've had any meetings with any of the housing developers like Tours. So have you had DeNova Housing go through there? Have you had Burbank Housing go through there? Have you had commercial developers go through there to find out what kind of market there is and if this can be developed in the current environment?
Yeah, I mean, we have not had specific tours, right? The intent, I mean, this part of the sort of separation that we had with the state was the state, you're in the driver's seat for disposition. We will stay out of that and we will have this more local planning process. That said, you know, we, when I think about our planning advisory team, it's a good mix, right? We have community leaders local to Glen Ellyn, to the Springs, to Sonoma. We have people that are in the like housing, affordable housing developer industry. We have developers that have success in building in the region for market rate. And so, you know, they've been a really great sounding board. As to actually doing tours and things like that, you know, we're not involved in that.
Thanks, Brian.
Commissioner Pogranti, do we have any follow-on questions from any of our commissioners? Commissioner Rouse?
But is that something we should do? I mean, when you think about it, when you look what we've got, and you bring a KB Homes in there and you say, okay, we've got X number of homes we believe we can build in this area. What can you, at this rate, what can you build these houses for and sell them for? Because again, affordable housing is great, but affordable housing means nothing if it's not truly affordable to the folks who are looking for affordable housing, right? I mean, it's we talk about affordable housing, but if $700,000 is affordable housing, it's not truly affordable housing, right? Not to the base that we're trying to embrace here. So, I mean, shouldn't that be part of what we do? To Pat's point, isn't that something we should? I don't know that it's our responsibility, but bringing housing developers in and saying, okay, so here's what we've got, here's what we think we can do, is this feasible? And if it's feasible, what is the cost to the consumer? Because I laugh at affordable housing, because affordable housing is it sounds good, but $700,000, if that's an affordable house, is not affordable to the people that we are trying to get housed in our community. So how do we solve for that? That to me is of the utmost importance.
Yeah, I mean, I think part of it is the increasing supply for affordable units. I think it's gonna take a partnership between county, between state, between the private sector, nonprofit, to really make an impact. And that said, this site, Sonoma Valley, is not the cure to our housing challenges. It's a component, and what we feel is a right size contribution to the larger topic and the larger issue. But I think part of that is, you know, how do we incentivize developers to bring more housing product and to bring different housing product? This is something that we haven't seen. You know, we see here, or not here, but where I live in Petaluma, there's a number of successful small lot subdivisions that sell, that are, you know, under the typical housing price, which is, I think, getting close to $1 million. And so that's not the intent here with this plan and with the vision. And so anything that the commission feels would make a stronger policy to achieve that intent, that's something I welcome.
Thank you, Commissioner Ralph.
Thank you.
Oh,
yeah, just
please, Commissioner Donovan.
Just a comment to follow up on that. You know, one of the opportunities for that, you mentioned public-private partnerships, are land trusts, or community land trusts. And my recollection was that is one of the proposals that has been put forward for consideration from Glen Ellen. Have you had any interactions with other community land trusts so that the entire land becomes affordable and in perpetuity and is managed by the land trust?
Yeah, so early on, I took this project on when I started. So it's been almost 2 years now. At the onset, we were 1 year into this 3 year process. I started having, focused discussions with our local builders, our affordable housing builders, our housing trust. And so some of those early discussions helped inform ultimately where we're at. And again, the intent of this specific plan is to hit a number of objectives. There's nothing that says a land trust couldn't work here. And Supervisor Gorin has mentioned, publicly just the how the county tried and looked into that as an alternative. Is something that absolutely has been considered by the county.
Thank you.
Brian, let's see, I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you.
You can, okay, yes. Good. Yeah. So in the exploring of the different types of housing units, has there been much exploration as far as rental housing, rental units, apartments, in order to create more affordable housing for those who truly can't afford to purchase?
Yes, so part of the analysis that I'll be sending at the conclusion does look at the demand, right? And so essentially there's an inexhaustible demand. We don't have inexhaustible space for this site. And so again, site appropriate, but we do recognize, so that's a housing type that could fit essentially anywhere housing could fit on SDC, we envision it to be both a mix of for sale plus rental units.
And when you were talking about the lot sizes and the height densities, how does that affect if somebody wants to put in an apartment complex and maybe it's three stories high? Is that possible?
There's a maximum building height. And so part of that is a recognition that this is not, downtown Petaluma. And so looking at the existing heights of buildings, both on campus and also throughout the project area, we're proposing height limits. And so a project could not come in without some future entitlement and discretionary action to come in higher than that.
Okay, thank you.
Brian, just along those lines, I'm going to ask one question here myself because it ties into that question that was just asked. So there is that height limitation and somebody could potentially put a request forward to the county for something that actually went above that height restriction. What expectation do you have that as this is developed, people would be coming before this body for some opinion or some resolution surrounding what they're asking for, either permit-wise or other?
Just like any other land use entitlement or project that gets referred to the Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Committee Commission, a future project would have to follow suit.
Thank you. I wanted that to be clear. It's not something that's explicit here, but there is a process whereby which, if something's happening, we will be part of that process, or the future body will be. So I just thought that was important to put out there. Commissioner Lowe.
Thank you. The discussion of height requirements compelled me to ask this question. Is there an ability to go underground in terms of parking and those sort of things?
No.
There's no ability to do underground parking.
I don't believe we have any. No, I mean, that would have to go through a entitlement process.
Okay. We do have underground parking in the city of Sonoma being used very successfully in one of our relatively newer projects. So it might be something to look at.
You know, what's interesting is the site is, it has ample on-street parking. And so that was another, I mean, there's a whole inventory of underutilized curb space throughout the campus. And so, we recognize that. I think one of the key transportation policies that will live beyond adoption of the specific plan and through implementation is the establishment of a transportation management association. And so think HOA, homeowners association. It will have a similar objective of management of transportation to try and get our trips down, to try and get our vehicle miles traveled down. And to me, part of that is efficient use of our curb spaces and our parking allocation.
And again, once again, you've hit on a topic that raises two of my questions. So I'll go ahead and ask them and intersperse them with the other commissioners. That curve on the north side going out of the SDC just after you go over the bridge is a high speed area that I observe all the time. It's also the wildlife corridor primary spot. Is there anything in this plan that addresses kind of that speed trap for fawns and deer and et cetera?
So this is north of the bridge?
Correct.
Yeah, so part of the commitment has always, so there's currently two, I think maybe even three residential cabins on west side of Arnold, directly across from the access point to Sutton Field. Mm-hmm. And so the proposal is to demolish, for a future developer to demolish and retain that as the critical wildlife habitat. There is a much larger regional discussion that is being led by our county parks department to look at not just the safety, but also the sort of organization of the curve, because it's you go on the weekends and it's a very popular recreational entry point. And so there's nothing, I mean, I think there's a few, there is policies related to working with our counterparts, such as parks, to look at things, but that is outside of the footprint of the campus, right? So what the specific plan entails is just focused on the core campus.
I've heard of discussions about that outside of this process. Okay, thank you for that. And then just the one other question that just begged a question of why aren't we picking an access point from the campus to Highway 12? I thought that was a little odd that we're giving flexibility surrounding either the south edge or through the center there. And I just would think that that would be something that was
easily selected. So I just wanted to get some idea from you what that thought process was.
Yeah, so part of the, so the proposed project includes a connection. The reason why, I mean, there isn't a simple choice, like a clear choice. And so there's likely, well, there will be additional environmental, it'll be a sort of part two, right? So we do the specific plan, and then there will be this follow-up analysis and assessment and building potentially of the road. And so we didn't want to get ahead of that. At the end of the day, for the purpose of this project, it is just the idea that there is going to be a connection, not specifically where. There's a lot of natural resources within the open space on the east side. There's an existing fire road that gets close to Highway 12, and so there's a couple options, and it's just not something that was part of this project.
Right, and then you basically brought me to my last question, which is natural resources, and is there a component in here about native plant usage throughout the development?
Yes, so planting native plants is, that's all you can do.
You've answered my question. Thank you. Appreciate it. Other questions from commissioners at this point? Okay. Our next step then is to turn to our public, and we have a few people who have raised their hands. I am going to remind people that I'm going to tell people they have 2 minutes to ask their questions, so please be succinct. And you know what, I'm going to give it 2.5 minutes. This is an important topic, and so I think we can live with 2.5 minutes. There aren't that many people in attendance. So Ariel, if you could use 2.5 minutes as the time. And I think we have some hands up, and you can go ahead and choose them in the order that they've risen them.
Sure. Give me 1 second to reset the timer, and I will. Okay, so first we have Tom Conlin, followed by Fred Auerbach, and then Alice. So let me share the screen. We'll pop out my participants. Okay, Tom, you should be able to unmute.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you, commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity tonight to speak on this item. And excellent questions from many of the commissioners tonight. Appreciate all of that. Brian, I don't know if you can answer specific questions from the public tonight, but I am struggling to understand, and I hope your professional experience as a planner can help me with this. I'm wondering how different this plan looks from a hypothetical mixed-use plan for a similarly sized privately owned piece of land. I realize that the enabling legislation calls for financial viability, but we should be taking into account that the current property owner spends billions of dollars a year to purchase and rehabilitate privately owned property, specifically for the purpose of adding net new affordable housing units to the supply side of the market. And I've been struggling because the new plan calls for, indeed it prioritizes, new non-residential development on the site, which we know will add new housing demand, approximately 900 new jobs, as I understand it, including a hotel, which we know has relatively low wages and therefore a higher demand on affordable housing supply, which we know to be in very short supply. So I'm wondering if this, the nature of the existing site ownership was taken into account during the specific planning process and how different this site plan looks because the state is the owner. The state was given the land for public use many, many years ago. And so that's my question. Thank you for consideration of the comments.
What we're going to do is have everybody ask their question. Brian, I think there are enough, if you can hopefully take notes to each of those questions and then answer them after we've received the questions from the public, that would be great.
All right, and next we have Fred. Fred, you should be able to unmute.
Thank you. Good evening, Chair Freeman and members of the commission, and it's good to see Tom Rouse out and about again. I have a question for Brian about the attainable housing or affordable by design. And Brian, if you could just hold forth some more on you know, what percentage of the total you would expect that to be, and whether those, you know, are multifamily units or what type of units are they? Are they smaller square feet or what makes them attainable? And, you know, what, I don't know if you can say, but, you know, are the price points going to be less than market rate for those? So that's basically my question. Thanks very much.
Okay, next we have Alice followed by Terry, and I do see a couple of phone attendees. So if you would like to raise your hand, if you're on the phone, you can press *9 to raise your hand. Okay, Alice, you should be able to unmute.
Yeah, hi, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much. So I just wanna say, you know, when we talk about money for a developer, we're also talking about money for the county, because the more housing and commercial that is built, the more property and sales taxes that come rolling into the county coffers year after year after year. And so upfront taxes and fees paid by developers do not cover infrastructure and road maintenance services required in the future. So when we talk about economic feasibility, I wanna know really who are we talking about? And I'm sorry, respectfully, Brian, in your answer to Commissioner Spaulding, I heard a lot of words, but I didn't really hear an answer. You know, is the county just so enamored of future property taxes that the historic preservation alternative, which has been identified as the environmentally superior alternative, that it's just not even being considered as a viable option? Meaning that, you know, the historical preservation alternative might pencil out for a developer, but not for the county in comparison to all of the taxes that could be coming in with the preferred plan. And I mean, maybe I'm missing something, but I don't think an economic feasibility study has really been done for this specific plan. And I mean, the county found money to do an economic feasibility study for the Eldridge Enterprise proposal. I don't understand why they can't find money to do a real study for their own plan. I'm a little confused by that. And I guess that's it for me. Thank you so much, everyone.
All right, next we have Terry. Oops, one second. Okay, Terry, you should be able to unmute.
Good evening, Chair Freeman and commissioners. Terry Shore, 515 Hopkins Street, Sonoma Valley, longtime environmentalist. I urge the commissioners to not approve the resolution directing the Planning Commission to approve the specific plan or the FEIR, the final environmental impact report, or for the county to move forward with the rezoning. If you get a chance to finish reading the EIR, you will see among the 1,200 comments, thousands of reasons why the specific plan and the EIR need to be significantly revised. Instead, I urge you to urge the Planning Commission to send the specific plan and the EIR back to the staff to revise it, to fully address the comments, to scale back the development as the community has asked, to keep it in public hands, and to better protect the open space. I'm actually disappointed that the discussion tonight has been focused primarily on the details of a large mega development and no discussion about scaling it back or any real serious discussion about the impacts to the open space, the wildlife corridor, the creek that runs through that property. And I do appreciate Chair Freeman's concerns about the wildlife corridor. We all should be realizing that housing demand is inextinguishable, as I think Mr. O said, and we should not be putting a huge development in the middle of a rural community. It goes against decades of city-centered growth at the local, regional, and state level. There's plenty of room to build in other places, and if you do build here, we really need to scale it back. We are in a biodiversity crisis, we're in an extinction crisis, and we're in a climate crisis, and this project will exacerbate all of those without any doubt. So thank you very much. I think delaying the process is not going to have any major consequences. At least no one has given me any specifics. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm not seeing.
You're on mute, Ariel, but you're on mute. Any additional, no additional hands?
There were no additional hands, but now there are. So we're okay. Going to go to Roger, followed by Sharon, and then Nick. Just let me reset the timer.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, Roger, you should be able to unmute.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to comment. A couple of questions. Brian, you discussed the phasing of the project, and it could be a period of quite a few years before the full build out. I'm wondering if you start the project and let's say 10 years in, the impacts are different and more significant than had been anticipated, whether that would cause the vesting or the rights for any further development to be reconsidered, or are those set and solid based on what we know today as opposed to what might occur in 10 years into the future. Secondly, you mentioned a lot of curb space for parking, and that was an attractive opportunity to use that. I'm wondering if each of those parking spaces are going to be set up with any kind of plug for electric vehicles and charging. And then finally, just in terms of looking at this size project versus a downscaled project, I didn't really get a sense from the final EIR or the draft EIR for that matter of what the traffic impacts were of those lesser amounts. I think there was a statement to the effect that they were significant, but they weren't gone into great detail because they were significant. And so it didn't seem worth the time and effort to do that. I think it would be good to have a perspective on what traffic impacts might be scaled back depending upon how far you scale back the project. maybe I missed that, but it'd be helpful to understand that. Thank you.
Okay, next we have Sharon, followed by Nick and then Richard. Sharon, you should be able to unmute.
Hi, this is Sharon Church from Glen Ellen, and I appreciate the questions the commissioners have posed tonight and the time spent on this and the comments from the public that have preceded me. I think Terry Shore really nailed it, and I'm here to second her suggestion that you hold off and have this scaled back and take a closer look at it. We're rushing into something with a false date, a false timeline, and we're ignoring what's happening environmentally with the climate, with everything else. And we're doing like a 1980s project in San Jose. I mean, this absolutely makes no sense to me. I know you're all sitting there volunteering your time with 2,500 pages that most of you, I'm sure, haven't gotten through. I sure haven't. So let's take a pause. Listen to Terry's very astute comments and her request, and I ask that you take a pause and do not recommend moving forward with this tonight. Thank you.
Okay, Nick, you should be able to unmute.
Hello, commissioners, and thank you for your presentation, Mr. O. Mr. O mentions the support of this plan from the planning advisory team. Over a year ago, the PAT told Permit Sonoma their plans are way too big for this site. Ultimately, 12 of the 14 PAT members wrote a letter to Permit Sonoma saying that our input was not being listened to, and that letter stated the plans were going in the wrong direction and the advisory process of the PAT had broken down. Please recommend the historic preservation alternative become the preferred alternative. The appropriately scaled historic preservation alternative, the environmentally superior alternative, according to Permit Sonoma's analysis, is also superior in every other way. This adjusted scale, the historic preservation alternative, will immediately mitigate all the community's concerns. Concerns about emergency evacuation, concerns about traffic congestion, and concerns about negative impacts on the wildlife corridor. The Sonoma Valley community is ready to support a reasonable scale, the reasonable scale of the historic preservation alternative. We are excited to have significant levels of housing for our vulnerable citizens. We are thrilled that we will have new housing for essential workers like teachers, firefighters, police officers, and tradespeople. Additionally, Mr. O mentions that Sonoma County is not a developer, but Permit Sonoma is creating the parameters for developers in the specific plan. Please insert the baseline of 450 units that the historic preservation alternative lists. Please insert that baseline of 450 units into the housing range included in the final specific plan. And please don't feel intimidated by the canard of financial viability. The community is aware of this component, but it should not be the only driver of this discussion. Various professional developers have been studying the site and have identified unit numbers of 375, 470, and 600 units as a scale that would assure that each of these groups can turn a profit. Let's plan this at the appropriate scale. The scale of the historic preservation alternative will mitigate all the community's concerns and will still turn a tidy profit for our developer neighbors. We can do this correctly, and your recommendation will help assure that. Thank you for this meeting. I just want to say that we've only had one in-person public meeting the whole time, and that was last month's planning commissioner meeting. But the community cares, and we know that you commissioners care also. Thank you so much for getting this right.
Okay, next we have Richard, and I'm not seeing other hands. So if anyone else would like to speak, please do raise your hand. If you're on the phone, please press star 9. And Richard, you should be able to unmute.
Thank you. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity and been very interested in and supportive of many of the comments that have been made prior to this comment. Sonoma Ecology Center's concerns have been definitely, I think, considered in the specific plan. And we're especially pleased with the proposed removal of buildings in the narrow part of the wildlife corridor. But of course, we do have several concerns. And these are mostly directed, since I think many of the comments before have been the open space up to the non-open space pieces. We're interested in the open space parts of the campus. There's intensive land use still allowed in protected open space, especially on the east side, that's not compatible with rare species and habitats. And we really feel the plan needs to exclude uses like nurseries, timber conversions, confined animal operations for most or all of the protected open space outside the core campus. Second, setbacks from Sonoma Creek in the draft plan and Hill Creek as well are 50 feet, the same that's used when creeks run through neighborhoods. That's not appropriate when SDC hosts sensitive water-dependent species like steelhead, Chinook salmon, beaver, and is a critical wildlife habitat corridor. Because so many buildings near creeks will be removed or rebuilt, we have a chance at SDC to widen creek setbacks and to do right by the extraordinary natural legacy of this site. Thirdly, we remain opposed to the permanent road that would go through to Highway 12 because the sensitive species that live in that area, such as protected western pond turtles and Pacific giant salamanders, we could support an unpaved, unlighted road that is only used in emergencies. We have many more comments and we'll put them in writing, and we thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Okay, and with that, Chair Freeman, I'm not seeing other hands.
Okay, I appreciate that. 10. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now call the public comment or question period closed for this portion of the meeting. And at this point, I'd like to turn it back to Brian, if I may, and ask him to, with any assistance from us, try to address some of the comments or questions asked by the public. Mr. O.
Thank you, Chair, and members of the public for public comment and questions today. So I'll just start from the first speaker, Tom, and just go in order. So Tom's question about hypothetical footprint for a private developer using similar parameters, it's hypothetical. I mean, I'm not a private developer. I think we have gotten input through various developers, whether it's on the advisory team, whether it's through our consulting firm, and just some of the feedback that we've received. I don't have any vision of what it would look like should it not have been a county-led effort. And so just, I think, just highlighting the idea and the commitment that the county, right, the public representatives or the public entity, the lead agency made with the state 3 years ago was that this would not be a private developer led effort. I just wanted to highlight that it's, might be fun just to think about what it looks like, but this is not, that's not in my purview or expertise. To Fred's question about affordable by design and how much of it. So there is a policy sort of, it's more of a, it's like a suggested encouragement, again, recognizing, needing some flexibility for a 20-year build out. The idea would be with the limitations, all housing product here, both for sale, rental, single family attached, single family detached, multifamily, they will all be affordable by design on top of the deed restricted units. And so there's not a number in there besides just, you know, what we have already discussed, right? The base being 733 units. Of that, 550 market rate, that affordable by design, and then any of the additional bonus would all need to abide by all the design and development standards identified in the specific plan. Alice's question about economic feasibility and alternatives and why we're not taking a closer look at options. This is the staff recommendation. That said, as directed by the board, we did look at a range which is inclusive of the 450 that we hear from the community. There's a really great comparison in the draft EIR. It starts on page 574 or 576 that really shows you the difference in impact across the alternatives. And so again, we have to weigh that with all the other project objectives. And so it's there. It's something that ultimately the Planning Commission may make a recommendation for one alternative over the other. And same goes with the Board of Supervisors. So there will be a public hearing similar to this with in front of Planning Commission to start tomorrow afternoon. And we are scheduled to go to the board on the 16th of December. And that to allow additional time for Planning Commission to deliver the best product and plan to the board. And then the question about property tax, I can honestly say it has not crossed my mind aside from, you know, just paying my own property tax yesterday. So that's my answer for that. And for Terry, keep it in public hands. Again, we're not in charge here with the disposition. The state is. I am not part of, the county is not part of the disposition. It is owned by the state, not owned by, you know, fortunately not owned by a private entity. And they have been clear from the start that they will complete a disposition to a project sponsor. That could be a public entity, that could be a private developer, a set of private developers, not the County of Sonoma. And questions about, you know, a false sense of a time. The state legislation is crystal clear, both from a legal interpretation and from what the Board of Supervisors has committed, that we will complete this process within the 3-year timeframe. And so I am not a pushy person by any means. I hope that doesn't come across, and I've never communicated the big, you know, stick that is the timeline, but it is a fact. It is a 3-year process. I have no idea what happens after that. It's not written in the state legislation. So all I have in front of me as lead staff is to complete what the county has committed to as part of the state legislation. She also had another question about alternatives. So in a similar response to Alice's question, they're there. You know, that's ultimately what the Planning Commission and the Board of Supervisors' role in this to adopt is, to consider all the facts, to consider the, you know, all the reports and all the public input that happens at the public hearings that will come. And ultimately they may, that is an option to pick an alternative over another. Roger Peters had a question about future impacts and or maybe unforeseen future impacts and influence. And so, you know, this is a decision point, you know, at this point. And so potentially the Board of Supervisors would adopt the specific plan, certify the environmental impact report, and that will start a redevelopment process likely to take 20 years. And so that is what the any redevelopment will have to follow is what is adopted by the specific plan by the Board of Supervisors. We had a question about parking space allocation. There's a ratio in the design standards around how many EV charging stations and spaces shall be built as part of the number of housing units. And then the question he had about the vehicle miles traveled and the perceived lack of information in the draft environmental impact report across the alternatives. And so I think one thing that's lost here is you look at, so just to clarify for transportation, the number of vehicle miles traveled, it is a significant unavoidable impact across the board. And so rather than I think what we are typically accustomed to is, okay, more people, twice as many people, there has to be a transportation impact. What the state is evaluating through CEQA is how many miles is that person traveling? And so it doesn't matter if it's 450 people versus 1,000 people in terms of vehicle miles traveled, that distance is still going to be relatively the same. And so there's an average that the Bay Area has per person. We run the model, we plug in the 1,000 units, we come under that. The reason why it's significant and unavoidable is because we don't, we aren't within the recommended threshold of 15%. And so that's where the Transportation Management Association will come in, is how are we going to fund different programs to try and reduce those vehicle miles traveled in the future for future employees and future residents. Sharon had a question about state timeline. Again, the only thing I've ever seen is the state legislation with dates. And so we have a date with Planning Commission and we have a date with the Board of Supervisors for their consideration. And again, I think, you know, I think we should keep in mind, I mean, there is a public process. There's a hearing process that will happen, not just here, but with the Planning Commission, with the Board of Supervisors. And so I, you know, just wanted to just highlight the fact that there will be additional opportunity for public engagement and comment to the decision makers. Nick, my offer to have coffee is still open. It's been, you know, that's a longstanding offer. And so I never said that there was agreement with the PAT. What Nick is referencing is there were a number of PAT members that were included in the letter. It was not a unanimous letter. And I think at the end of the day, it's, you know, the advisory team was there to provide a diverse set of voices and perspectives. And I think we've accomplished that by hearing a diverse set of voices and perspectives. Richard's question about permitted uses. So there is an updated permitted use table, which I wish I had included in my PowerPoint, but you'll see it in the staff report for Planning Commission tomorrow. It's also been posted and advertised through our website that we put up, I think 8 days ago. And so there's a revision. So if you look at the permitted use table, table 4-3, the revised version, it is what we are proposing for preserved open space. There's zero permitted uses. There are a number of conditional uses, which again, will Chair Freeman would go through some entitlement process, just like any other conditional use permit that you see. And those are much more focused on, I think, the intent that the county has. Conditional use permit for community garden, food cultivation, animal keeping, or beekeeping. But any of the uses that Richard had identified are no longer being proposed as the allowable uses in the preserved open space. And then question about creeks setback. It's a 50 foot on both sides setback. Again, that's, you know, I think there's difference of opinion on how wide the setback is, but in establishing a 50 foot wide creek setback for both Mill Creek and Sonoma Creek, we are expanding the existing riparian corridor for both creeks, as well as additional expansion. Richard mentioned the pinch point for the wildlife corridor. And I think I covered everything, but please let me know if I missed something.
I think we've got all of my notes covered. So anything wasn't covered, if you wouldn't mind speaking up, fellow commissioners, but otherwise I think you did a fine job of covering those. Better job than I would have done covering my notes. So thank you, Mr. O. We really appreciate you taking the time with us here. I know it's been a long process for you. We appreciate all the work that you do, and know that there is no malice in what you do, but also know that you as a fellow citizen care a great deal about our valley as well. So we really appreciate everything you're doing.
Thank you, Chair.
Now, I think the fun part begins. Looking forward to hearing from comments from my fellow commissioners, and glad to see there are some hands already up. Mr. Rouse, if you would start off, please.
Well, I would like to say that I've been on this commission for a total of a month, so but I have followed this for obviously much longer than that. And when the public speaks, and Terry and the rest of you, I think that we talk about false timelines, and I love the comment about the 80s project in San Jose, because it sometimes feels that way in what I've seen and what I've read and what I've and what I've experienced. I think what we can all, I would agree that I don't know what the real timelines are. There are things that have to happen, but you have heard that this is a 20-year timeline. All of you have heard that. And I think it's important to understand that I too would like to slow this thing down. And I too don't know that I feel like a thousand housing units is something that I think is a good idea. So I think all of us, at least from my own perspective, and I can't speak for the rest of the commission, but I can speak to those that are on tonight and concerned, that we have a long way to go. I mean, there's going to be a lot of public comment, and nothing is going to happen, I don't believe, for a very long time. And there will be course correction that occurs here. So I think we can all leave today, tonight, and say, okay, this is what we've heard. The public would like more pushback. Again, I personally have not read all 2,500 pages of that EIR. I've tried, but I've not gotten through it. So I think that I can say with a great deal of confidence that we've got a long way to go. And whatever happens from the Planning Commission and at the supervisor level, that that's not the end result of what's going to happen. There's going to be a lot of public commentary that is taken into consideration, and we are all very, very far away from what's actually going to happen at the SDC. So don't get too caught up in where we are today, because I believe the process will continue for a much longer period of time. And maybe I'm naive, but I don't believe that I am. I've seen this process before, and take comfort in knowing that there will be a whole lot more consideration given to what options we have as a community to move this thing forward in a way that perhaps not everybody can agree on, but will agree that it is the best course of action long-term. That's it for me.
Thank you, Commissioner Rouse. Commissioner Lowe?
Thank you. And in the event this doesn't go on for very long and we are making an opinion that could ultimately be the opinion that is regarded as the final opinion, I think I'd like to weigh in a bit. I just want to point out a few things from the letter that the city of Sonoma sent in response to the draft. And just if I'm not going to read you the whole letter, it's in there on page 2500 and something or other. Anyway, first of all, we do not support a hotel or the hospitality overlay for many of the reasons previously stated. We also, of the alternatives, supported the historic preservation alternative, which was also the North Valley Map's opinion, and it was brought up on this this evening by Nick Brown. And we also took exception to some of the transportation impacts. We felt that they did not sufficiently analyze the impact through the springs in El Verano and into the city of Sonoma, which would absolutely be impacted by whatever was chosen. And we felt that that was remiss in the overall analysis. But I just ask, I'm sure Mr. O is quite aware of our letter, but and just for the purpose of this company, I just wanted to bring that up and let you know officially it was voted on in, by all five of us and submitted. And many of these points were brought up, and I just want to emphasize them on behalf of the city. And I know Mr. Felder is here too. He's the actual member. I'm just here for, I'm the alternate, but I've been following this so diligently. I ask your indulgence in allowing me to comment. Thank you.
Appreciate your comments. Thank you, Commissioner Lowe. Commissioner Dickey, please, and then I'll go to Commissioner Spalding, and then I'll go to Commissioner Chrysler.
Firstly, I'd like to thank everybody who's participated in these many, many now years of meetings and their comments, their input, their concerns. And to Chairman Freeman's point, there is no malice in my comments tonight, but there is discontent. And so with that, I'll proceed. We, the residents of the Sonoma Valley, have been subjected to a breach of the public trust in regards to SDC and the process of project development. We were assured the effort to develop a plan for SDC would be inclusive and transparent. A sea of acronym-laden local public bodies were available to permit Sonoma as a source for public input. The PAT, the North Sonoma Valley MAC, the Springs MAC, and the Sonoma City Council all made efforts to voice ideas, concerns, and a vision for environmental and community compatibility. Our voices were clearly ignored by Permit Sonoma as it pursued this proposed specific plan in the insular vacuum of its own offices. Permit Sonoma refers to this process as a, quote, programmatic EIR, unquote. As I've stated previously, SDC could be a site that reflects Tomorrowland. Instead, we are left to consider a project which merely checks the boxes from a development template entitled Yesterdayville. So we're left to concern an EIR for a project, which instead should be considered an EAR, an environmental abuse report. Both the natural and social environment have been abused during this process. I suggest we vote against this report and ask the Planning Commission and the Board of Supervisors to direct Permit Sonoma to create a specific plan that is reflective of both our commitment to the environment and the social pact with the Sonoma Valley. I want to thank you all again for participating tonight.
Thank you, Commissioner Dickey. Appreciate your comments. Commissioner Spaulding, I believe you were.
Thank you. I not only have no malice, I have a great deal of respect for Mr. O, and I have a feeling I do know one thing that's going to happen at the conclusion of the next Board of Supes meeting, and that is Mr. O is going to take some time off. I hope he enjoys it. I'm actually prepared to make a motion, but I would, of course, wait until all my fellow and sister commissioners have spoken. I think there are four things that I'm proposing we consider in making our recommendation. And the first is simply, this is too big a development. It's the scale is inappropriate. Second is the data to support financial feasibility remains vague or essentially unavailable. Impact the critical issues of fire safety, traffic, and especially the wildlife corridor. Excuse me, I'm losing my voice. The impacts are that have been announced seem unrealistic, unsustainable, unsubstantiated, and frankly optimistic. It ain't going to work that way. Fourth was that the reliance on much of this EIR is saying that, well, we're not making a decision about this or that because it'll be made at the actual project is proposed to be built, whether it's hotel or residences or whatever, businesses. But given all of the amazing antipathy to this EIR and this project, I think we have reason to be skeptical that future EIRs for specific projects will go according to community interest. So I think we're just skeptical about that future. Those are four things that worry me. I defer to my colleagues, and as I say, I'm happy to make a motion.
Thank you, Commissioner Spaulding. I may come back to you. Commissioner Felder?
Yes, I just want to voice my agreement with Commissioner Lowe's summary on what the position of City of Sonoma is, and I totally support Vice Chair Dickey on his position, and I think we should reject what has been given us by Permit Sonoma and make that rejection known to both the Planning Commission and the Board of Supervisors.
Thank you, Commissioner Felder. Commissioner Chrysler.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Mr. O for his excruciatingly hard work on this project and his patience and detailed answers to our questions. It is very hard to fathom the impact of this project over the next 20 years. And I second the concerns of Commissioner Spaulding as well. The community comments are overwhelmingly clear that they want the proposed project to be scaled back. 1,000 housing units seems to be way too many, and it seems like less than half of that would be more appropriate. And I went ahead and I did some map overlays of the size of the space that we're working with some of the higher density communities, both in Petaluma, in Rohnert Park, and other areas. And getting 1,000 housing units in there just really seems like a lot. And when you think about the fact that most housing units call for 2 cars, that's 2,000 cars on the road, it's a lot. I feel like the goal of 900 jobs is likely unrealistic in this location. And you know, the SDC is no longer. And I think we need to think about it differently. We aren't replacing those jobs. It's a different era that we're going into. And I actually feel like having 900 jobs in that location would have a negative impact in the density. It's too much. One of the things that I was thinking about tonight was there's no guarantee of what kind of businesses are going to be coming into this project. But what the community will need, especially if we're talking about lower income people, people with disabilities, and trying to create a walking environment, is schools, grocery stores, banks, the laundromat, the things that people need for their day-to-day lives. And so it would be nice if there could be some kind of consideration for, you know, the necessary businesses, as opposed to, you know, what have you. And I agree with the comments made before that a hotel's not a good fit in this neighborhood. It's going to take space away from the residents and give it to tourism. And trust me, I like the tourists, but this isn't the right place for it. And one of the things that Mr. O said tonight was that it doesn't necessarily have to be a hotel. It can be another type of business that may be able to take on the project of that large historic building. And perhaps it's just a matter of verbiage where it's been called hotel. And, you know, maybe changing that verbiage to other types of businesses might make it a little bit more palatable, and we can start, you know, maybe trying to encourage, you know, some sort of think tank or something to go in there. And lastly, I know that there is an environmental impact, but I do think it is very important that we have that road between Highway 12 and Arnold Drive, both to sort of mitigate the day-to-day traffic of however many homes and business people come into this environment, but also for a safety measure in case of another wildfire. I think that is an important thing. And like I said, I realize that there's going to be an environmental impact, but I think it's important. Anyway, that's my thoughts.
Appreciate it. Commissioner Brown.
I agree with a lot of what's been said previously, particularly with Commissioner Dickey, but I spent, as part of my preparation, I did read a lot of these pages, for what it's worth. Our mission statement of our SVCAC, and I was hoping for some inspirational language, and the best I got was some guidance, which was that we are to convey the sense of the community. I don't see how any argument can be made that the sense of the community is this is a really nifty idea, or this is something that's going to enhance everybody's lives, or even this is a proposal that's safe. 1,000 homes, that has never changed despite all the input, despite the, I don't know how many hours we've had on SVCAC on this and all the other community groups and the MACs that have discussed this, and all the people who put in endless time trying to provide good thinking and good analysis. It's never budged an inch. So that frankly is a concern to me, given the number of good ideas and critique that's come up during this meeting. This proposal does not work. It doesn't make sense. It's too big. It's not well thought. I read the statute. I'm appreciative of the legal requirements, at least in the statute. There's got to be another way for us to do our jobs and convey the sense of the community with some specifics to the county, to the Planning Commission, that will open the door for some more discussion.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown. Appreciate the thought. Do I have any other commissioners who would like to make comment at this point? Okay. Seeing none, I'll just make a few comments myself, which are just that as somebody who considers themselves somewhat an environmentalist, I do think it's too big. I do think listening to the people of that community, and I say that community, I don't mean that pejoratively. I just mean, you know, in the community that live up there. I mean, I lived on Hill Road for a good number of years and lived in that community. And I can't see 1,000 homes being placed in that spot without huge impacts, without, I mean, I just think of, you know, it's a lot to consider. And I just think that none of us really could foresee what that would really do to that area. And so I guess my thinking is very much in line with many of the comments which you guys have made. I also do think it is a long process, but I think we're kind of at a position right now where we kind of need to lay down a perspective that says the community, we've heard the community, and here's what the community says. The community says that this is too big, too focused on things that we don't quite understand because some of that information was not shared with us. And I know that the one thing that disturbs me the most or makes me feel most uneasy and probably on some level skeptical, according to Commissioner Spaulding's comment, is just that there's this overriding hand, which is supposedly this state who's saying, you need to figure it out, you need to figure it out, within the context of what we feel is right. And as a result, that's not giving us the right to say, this is what the community believes. And so I think we need to take a stand. Blah, blah, blah. Sorry. At this point, Commissioner Brown, did you have another comment or your hand is still up? But okay. I think at this point, unless somebody would like to stop us from going to this next step, I believe I would like to lean into Commissioner Spaulding's desire to put forth a resolution that I believe would be rounded out by comments from others here. So I think taking a first stab at it might be a nice thing from Commissioner Spaulding, and then we all can kind of give our rounding feelings towards it. Are you guys okay with that? Can I see a thumbs up or a shaking? Okay, great. Thank you, guys. Commissioner Spaulding.
With all respect, I hope this is more than a stab, but let's try. I move that we recommend to both the Planning Commission and the Board of Supervisors that this EIR for the SDC, excuse me, and the project proposal that it describes not be approved, that it not be accepted for the following reasons. First, it is of the wrong scale. It is too large. 1,000 units is too many units. Second, the reason it's so large is alleged to be the financial feasibility, the essential nature of the financial situation. But we don't know enough about that financial feasibility. We don't know the figures. So we're skeptical of their veracity. Three, the assessed impacts expressed in the EIR seem unreasonable. They seem unclear and optimistic, especially in the areas of fire safety, evacuation, other traffic, but most especially the impacts on wildlife in as currently described in that EIR are just not adequate. That is to say, the impacts will be unacceptable. mitigations are not adequate. The last reason that I would put forth to propose or to propose that we deny this, it's not an application, this EIR, is that it relies too much on the future approvals for specific parts of the development when we're already skeptical about the approval of the EIR process for this program. We're left with how would EIRs for specific projects be different, be more carefully considered and reflect the concerns of the community. That's a long-winded motion.
Worthy of the topic.
Can I second it?
Before you do, I do have exactly. A few hands up. So let's just have a few comments, and then we'll move to that, Commissioner Dickey. Thank you, Commissioner Brown.
I'd like to offer a friendly amendment, which is to include water among the list of areas in which we're not satisfied either with the analysis that was given or how the impact is on their recommendations.
Could I comment and say that initially I had both water and wastewater on my list of unrealistic assessments, and we could put them back.
Yeah, I'd also like to suggest if I'm reading the room correctly, and based on all the comments I've heard over the last 3 years, of whether this committee can also make a recommendation for the historical preservation option.
We can, and perhaps we should. I'd love to, my colleagues, the rest of the public say.
Why we hadn't.
I'm sorry, it was hard to hear you, Tim.
I was just saying I was surprised that nobody had, and that's the way I was feeling, but then I felt a little vulnerable. So frankly, I am in favor of doing that very, very, very item.
Can we make that a separate motion? I think that would be the most appropriate way to go.
Can I just ask one quick question to Ariel? Ariel, we can make two motions on this, can we not?
Sure, yes.
Okay, great. Just wanted to clarify, I wasn't aware, so thank you.
Sorry, I think according to somebody's
Bella,
yes.
Did you have your?
I do not have a comment.
Okay.
Thank you.
No worries.
If I may say, I think that typically we second and then we have discussion.
Okay.
I'd second the motion by Secretary Spaulding.
And at this point, I'll just ask you before I do go to a vote. Do you want to make a comment before we take that vote? You're on mute.
Your comment would come before the vote, right?
Pardon me?
Wouldn't the comment come before the vote?
Yes, that's what I'm asking if he wants to.
Yeah, I just had a question just for clarification that we are going to proceed with two resolutions, one for the majority of the discussion and a second to support the historic preservation model. Is that correct?
That is what I'm hearing, and that's what I believe we are going to have two resolutions on. Okay, yes, and I'm seeing a thumbs up from Commissioner Spaulding. At this point, then I would ask for all those in favor of supporting the first resolution, which is the long-winded resolution that we heard with the 4 to 5 points that I believe will be captured by Lynn Marie, and she just deserves a great deal of support from us. However, for those of you who support that resolution, please either give us a thumbs up or say aye.
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 Aye. Okay.
Seeing all thumbs up or ayes,
I now ask of anybody who believes in a nay. Not hearing any, the resolution passes unanimously. And now I ask us to go to our second resolution, which the group has discussed, which is to support the historic preservation alternative that has been placed before the commission. We know what that is. And all those in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. All those not in favor, say nay or thumbs down. Being no thumbs down, no nays, that resolution passes as well, unanimously. Thank you, Lynn Marie. Like to see a smiling face after that. Okay, so I believe that we are now moving off of item number 4 on our agenda and moving to item number 5, which is a report from our MAC liaisons. Unfortunately, the Springs MAC liaison that we have is excused tonight. I would ask Commissioner Dickey to give us an update on the North Valley MAC at this point.
Our meeting last week was largely about transportation and local road conditions. We prioritized for the Department of Transportation which roads we thought were in the worst shape and should be placed on any kind of priority list. Interestingly, Supervisor Gorin said that before she leaves office, she was going to make sure that the bridge that goes through the town of Glen Ellen is going to be resurfaced if she had to do it herself. I won't hold her to that, but I was really optimistic that it would get done.
So that was it. Okay, thank you for that update. And I don't think we have any other MACs that can update us at this point. So therefore, we have received the report from the North Valley MAC, and now we will go on to item number 6, which is consideration of future agenda items. I would turn to Ariel for this part of the communication.
Sure. So as you may recall, at your last meeting, we voted to hold our November meeting on November 30th. Since the regular night conflicts with Thanksgiving holidays. We also discussed the Kenwood Ranch and their preferences. So I have connected with them. They are not able to make it on the 30th. I did ask them if there were alternate dates that they might consider. I have not heard back from them, but coincidentally, I was also reached out to by Permit Sonoma because the county's draft housing element is going to be released. The final version of the draft housing element is going to be released in early November, and they would like to use a joint meeting as we were planning to do on the 30th with SVCAC and both MACs as part of the public hearing process. So that is what is going to be on the agenda for the 30th. And I will keep the executive team in the loop about the Kenwood Ranch. I did learn from the Kenwood Ranch that they are having a public, they plan to do a public community meeting that they want to present their project to the public and invite the community there. It's so far scheduled to be on November 12th, and I will send information on that to this commission as well as the MACs, and we will put it in our newsletter, et cetera, because it's something they want to promote to the community. So whether or not they decide to appear before the commission, you could still learn about the project that way, and you are still able to hear it. Even if they don't want to present. I'm just trying to work with them because it would obviously be ideal if they would be here to answer questions. So that is, yes, that is your November meeting. The other things we have sort of rolling around is there's a solar project that is not ready yet. So when that's ready, we will bring that before the commission as well.
Does anybody have anything that they would like to consider for future meetings that would fall into this category? Seeing no hands, I will say that we are finished with the consideration of future agenda items, which leads us to item number 7, which can I get a motion to adjourn the meeting? I'm seeing a lot of happy faces.
I will move to adjourn.
Thank you, Commissioner Rouse. Do I have a second on that?
A second.
Second. Okay. Third.
Here we go. All in favor, say aye.
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 Great meeting.
Yeah,
thank good you,
meeting.
Everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
Have a great Thanksgiving, much. Everybody. Thank you thank so you. Much. Thanks, appreciate everyone. It. Look forward to seeing you.
Same here. Bye.